Welcome back. So in the previous video, we have been discussed about introduction to the spur gear, and we have been discussed about the basic terminologies of the spur gear. So in this video, we are going to discuss mainly about the law of gearing, how the gearing process will takes place. So usually we know the purpose of the gear drive, what is the purpose of using the gear drive is in order to transmit the motion or either power, either it might be in the machineries or it might be in the vehicles. Even it is the types of gears what we are going to use, it is mainly used in the even from the small watches till the airplanes of that much of automobile sectors or vehicles where we are going to use even in the machineries. For example, if we take the lathe machine also, we are going to use as in a gear drive in order to transmit the power. Whenever are we going to transmit that power, on what basis or on what law the gearing will transmit the motion or power, that will be discussed in this video. Mainly we are going to discuss in this law of gearing. So you can able to see the law of gearing. Mainly this is considering by whenever the two gears are coinciding at one particular point. So mainly before discussing about that gearings, what we should know about it is how we are going to transmit the power or motion through the gears. So gears, how it can able to be transmit, on what law or on what basis the on what basic law the power or the motion can be transmitted with the help of the gears. And mainly the gears are able to transmit only for the smaller distance. So because mainly it is depends upon the velocity ratio of the both the driver gear and the driven gear, or both the gears which are going to be used, and not only the two gears. So it is used for the depends upon the application, the number of gears will be fixed. So all will be rotating in different direction to each other. All the gears will be not rotating in a same direction. So how many number of gears which is going to be fixed. So all the gears will be rotating in the different directions. That we should able to know before seeing the law of gearing. So we should able to know that. See, whenever it will be having in a contact, continuous contact between the two teeth, at least whenever it is rotating in opposite direction at one point, either one or two teeth will be continuously having a contact with the other gears. So then only whenever it is will be having a continuous contact between the two gears or two teeth, at least two or three teeth. So then only the power or the motion can able to be transmitted. So whenever it is will be coinciding, so the force will be transmitted from one gear to other gear in order to either it might be increasing speed or either it might be a decreasing speed. So for that mainly the gears has been used. Mainly as we know that the purpose of gears is in the vehicle, especially if we take as an example of the vehicle. So it will be used as either to increase or to decrease the speed of the engine, right? Even if you want to increase, we are going to shift the gear. Even if you want to decrease the speed, we are going to shift the gear only. So that is how. So it will be having a continuous contact along with the throttle. Then only the increase or the decrease of the speed in the inside the engine will takes place, right? So this is about the how the gearing principle works. Now we'll see about the law of gearing. So mainly you can able to see these are the two teeth or the two points where which will be having and coinciding at one particular point, where you can able to see this is the one teeth what we called as an C, and this is what we called as an D. And just we have been written a line, one is NN, that is it is coinciding between these two points, where you can able to see this is axis what we have been considering, or we have been drawn one axis line that is along with this NN line, where the both the will meet at one particular point. See, when both the when we going to both the points will be meet at one particular point, we are going to do this, right? So in order to have in a constant angular velocity ratio for all positions of wheels, the pitch point must be fixed for one for the two wheels, or to the normal common normal point of a contact two of two mating gears must passes through this pitch point. See what this law of gearing indicates, that in order to have in a constant or a continuous angular velocity, then only if it is will be having an angular velocity, then only it can able to any gear drives, then only it can able to transmit the power or a motion. So in order to have in a constant angular velocity ratio for all the position, whether it we have just taken as in a 2 year, if it is having a 4 or 5 or any number of wheels, so the pitch point must be fixed. Any one pitch point will be fixed. How we have been fixed the pitch point, you can able to see this, the N line and the axis line which we have been fixed here. So this pitch point will be fixed between the two wheels or the common normal point. Now because we have been considering these two wheels, so we have been fixed that between these wheels. If I am going to consider for the common normal, at the point of contact of two mating teeth must pass through the pitch point. Must pass through the pitch point. That is, it has to cross to this pitch point in order to transmit the velocity. Or what the velocity ratio? Velocity is nothing but it has to transmit the motion between the two wheels, or in order to function the to the given function. That is, in order to transmit the motion or the power. So when coming to this, whenever it is rotating, the one is rotating in the clockwise direction. So similarly, the other gear will be automatically, it will be rotating in the opposite direction. That we should able to know that. So one gear is rotating in a clockwise direction means automatically the other gear will be rotating in the opposite direction. Then only it can able to be contact or that one pitch point what we have been discussed. So the two mating, whenever the two mating teeth will be must pass through this, means at that particular point only it will be coinciding. The two mating teeth will be coinciding at this particular pitch point. This point what we called as in a pitch point, or what we called as in a mating gears, which will be having mating at this particular point. This is what we called as in a law of gearing. So both will be rotating in the opposite direction. It will, if the gear one is rotating in the clockwise direction, means automatically the gear two will be rotating in the anti-clockwise direction. At this pitch point, both the gears will be mating. Both the gears, either two or three teeth, will be coinciding or mating at this particular point. So now, based on this, considering how the law of gearing equation will be there. So first we'll see. A point C and the tooth, that is the gear one, will be in the contact with the point and the D. That is what we can able to see, this tooth profile gear. So that is C and D, what we have been taken the notations. So the two curves in contact at point C and D must have a common normal point. That is what we have been seen, that common normal point where it is going to be meeting at this. So that is what we have been considered as an N, and we'll consider this as an M, where it will be both will be having a constant meeting point. Coming now if the curved surface of the teeth of the two gears are remain in a contact on the surface, whenever it is sliding along with the common tangent, that is what we have been seen, it is been taken as in one tangent here. You can able to see, we have been drawn the tangent. So whenever the curved surface of the teeth of the two gears are remain in contact of one surface, may slide relative to the other along the common tangent. So the relative motion between the surface along the common normal must be zero in order to avoid the separation of each other. It should be zero in order to avoid the two teeth into the each other. Next, when the component, what we need to see, that component along the NN is, we can able to see the component along this NN should be V cos theta, and the component along the VD will be equal to VD cos theta, and the relative motion along the NN will be V cos theta into V sin theta. And when you join that AE and B into F, then the points A and B will be, points A and B will be having a respectively, the points A and B will can able to produce or can able to transmit the motion. That is, based on this law only, the all the gear drives will work. Maybe we have been considering here only the two gears, but if we coming to the real picture, so the more number of gears we have been considered in order to transmit the different motions. So based on this, at least it should be having a one common point, because if we are considering here, we have been considered only the two wheels. So hence we have been taken as one particular common point. But if you are having a more number of gears, so it will be having the, well, we have to fix the one common normal point for the contact between the mating gears. So this is how the law of gearing or the principle of law of gearing will work. So when finally they are drawing perpendicular, that is AA and BF, on the axis of NN from the points A to B respectively, if you join that line, so it can able to easily process the, or it can able to transmit the motion from one gear to the other gear for a particular application where we are going to be used. This is about the law of gearing.